BBC One tonight's Heart of the Matter. In a week which has seen British censors criticising Hollywood producers for showing too much violence in their films, Joan Bakewell asks if censorship is the best way to deal with controversial productions. This programme, which is a change to the Build edition, does contain material which some viewers may find disturbing.
The film Crash is in the dock. The film Visions of Ecstasy has been found likely to be blasphemous. Tonight, Heart of the Matter asks whether we're entering a new Puritan age or defending the vulnerable from depravity. And in an exclusive interview, we hear from David Cronenberg, the Canadian director of Crash, about his views on the British way of censorship.
Filmmakers have always been fascinated by sex and violence. Yet for us British, sex on the screen is somewhat embarrassing. Maybe it's better left to foreigners. And we're even more concerned about violence. And when the two are combined into sexual violence, we cry, enough, and scream at the censor, get out your scissors. Now along comes a film which suggests that sexual violence can lead to pleasure. That film, which was shot here in Toronto, is called Crash.
In a sense, sex is as subversive as art. Everybody knows that sex is not safe. It's very primitive, it's very wild, it's very unpredictable, it's very predatory, and it's not safe. Likewise, art is not safe, and yet we need sex and we need art. And so there's this tension that's always there.
We were interrupted. I had to go back to the set.
Poor darling. Maybe the next one.
The film is based on the novel Crash by the British writer J.G. Ballard, who describes the car crashes in his book as a nightmare marriage between sex and technology. The film itself explores a group of disaffected characters who can only find excitement and meaning in car crashes. When the film was shown recently at the London Film Festival, it caused an uproar, with various newspapers calling for it to be banned.
Flying into England for the London Film Festival, one is well aware that one is landing on an island. And I really did find the response to my film to be a kind of strange island response, you know, very, there's a siege mentality in England, I think. And a fear of being contaminated, which is a very island thing to do, to be a fear of being contaminated from the outside and then having that enclosed on the island and no way to get off. Very strange, very extreme. I've had many reactions from about 40 countries and nothing approaching the craziness that I found in England. Crash in England is being called a very violent film. It's absolutely not a violent film. I mean, there are no guns, there are no knives, there are no clubs. Nobody is shot or stabbed. Nobody is raped. All the sex is totally consensual. No one is even slapped in the film. In England, the sexuality cannot be dealt with in the film, and it is sexual. And so it becomes transformed in the English mind into violence. And then they can deal with the violence. And so suddenly, instead of being a sexual film, Crash is a violent film. That's what I think happened. There's a sort of phantom version of Crash going around that's been created by the press.
Is there something here that interests you?
This interests me. I'd like to see if I can fit into a car designed for a normal body. Could you help me into it, please?
Yeah, sure.
Are these safe cars?
Yes, of course, they're very safe.
I've had several people write me and call me saying that for the disabled, Roseanne is an icon, a heroine, because she's someone who refuses to become a withered, a kind of sexless creature because she has suffered mutilation in an accident, and in fact is very proud and strong in her own sexuality and her eroticism, and is trying to incorporate her new body, which is not the same as a normal body, into her sexuality, rather than trying to cover it up or pretend it's not there. If the film is an exploration that you're undergoing and that you're inviting others to come along with you on, once again, it's not you. It's not one-to-one you. It's not, you know, so it's a complex thing. And I would think that maybe a daily film reviewer would not understand something as complex as that. But someone who is a serious critic should, and most don't. And it leads them to ridiculous errors. And to me, it's the other face of the sort of the copycat thing. And I don't think critics much understand the relationship of an audience to a film either. I mean, it's unbelievable to me that a serious critic could posit that people seeing something on the screen will just go and do it. I mean, it's obviously not true. It's obviously a lot more complex than that. Otherwise, everybody who saw Braveheart would be painting his face blue and chopping people's heads off and wearing a kilt. Why not? I mean, they say, oh no, that's ridiculous. And I say, no, if your theory of reaction to film is correct, it's not ridiculous at all, and you have to tell me why it's not happening. With Crash, the film has been seen now by several million people, and nothing has happened in terms of traffic statistics or anything. I mean, we have proof. We don't have to guess with Crash. We have seen it in many different cultures now, and it has not resulted in any of these incidents that everybody is running around screaming about. I mean, the one thing is, if a killer goes into your movie and says, oh, I was going to shoot him, but now that I've seen a stabbing scene, I'll stab him instead. Well, to me, that's no reason to censor that film, because that is not the issue. The issue is, did that man go into the film not a killer and come out of it a man who's capable of killing? That's the real issue. It's a very convenient way of blaming society for what you are. And if that were true, one then could make a very strong case for censoring all news whatsoever. Because, of course, a murderer like Jeffrey Dahmer became famous. Really, censorship is never about morality. It's always about control and power and fear, always. In a totalitarian state, it's very clearly seen, and censorship makes a lot of sense in a totalitarian state. You, the dictator, suppress anything that you do not want to happen or hear. And whether it's a whim or a serious political conviction, it doesn't matter what the reason is that you want to suppress that. You don't have to justify it to anyone. In a democracy, censorship is a paradoxical thing, and generally a perversity, I think. And it leads you to and I can say this as someone who has been censored himself, that it is a very perverse and sick experience to be censored. It ends up you and someone else having an argument.
What,
two
you
people,
and you and the censor?
You and the censor, you and the board, you and whoever the person is who wants to censor you. And you immediately are dealing with their own specific fears, their own understanding of sexuality, their own education and film literacy, or just literacy in general, and it becomes a one-to-one thing where some one citizen of a mature age is trying to repress and suppress the voice of another, and that's it. And in a democracy, I don't see how you can justify that.
Is there any subject where you don't think the film camera should go into?
No, I don't think so. I think the artist's responsibility is to not be afraid and to not self-censor. And I think that all the great artistic discoveries and insights and intuitions have been made in a condition of fearlessness on the part of the artist and not self-censorship and not obeisance to some whatever social norm seems to be prevalent at the time. I mean, my interrelationship with my audience is as sacred as there's anything on earth as far as I'm concerned. It's my confessional, and it must not be tampered with. As soon as you start to censor, you're no longer an artist. You're an interior decorator. I mean, you might as well forget it.
I believe Crash has become the victim of a new wave of moral puritanism sweeping this country. Although the British Board of Film Classification has yet to decide whether to give the film a certificate, Councillor John Bull and Westminster City Council have demanded cuts before they will issue a license for the film to be shown in the West End.
I'm not so sure that there's real moral puritanism. I think there's a lot of posturing going on in England, and I think it's very political. The scary part, of course, is that in England, while I was there, I heard no one saying the word freedom, not one person. As though the word freedom, as in freedom of expression, freedom of speech, democratic freedom, was political suicide. It was becoming equated with license. Freedom equals license. Everybody was talking about control and suppression. And there's a huge condescension involved in any kind of censorship, and in particularly, I see it very clearly in England. It's as though all that colonial energy that used to go outwards is now being focused inwardly. So the colonials, you know, those colonials are here. They're in England now. They're on this island with us. And we won't be triggered off. I, John Bull of the Westminster Council, well, I can see this movie and it's not going to do anything to me. But those people out there who are what? Well, they're not like me anyway. They might do something. I mean, in terms of absurdity, Mr. Bull was interviewed. He seemed like a perfectly decent, nice man, completely out of his depth as a censor, but trying manfully to live up to that level. And he says, there's a line in the movie, he said, I think it's spoken by a character named Vaughn. It's completely unacceptable. It must be cut. The line is, the car crash is a fertilizing rather than a destructive event. Well, we can't have anybody saying that, he says. And he's just said it to 200,000 television viewers. I mean, is that not absurd or what?
Above all, the present fuss about Crash shows that film censorship in Britain doesn't work. Why do I believe that? Because all the evidence demonstrates that film censors don't ban films, newspapers do, and then the censor carries out their orders. But what is even worse, this kind of film censorship from the press demands that filmmakers always have to sustain society's values, never attack them. And the only result from that can be that films will be cut off from their roots in reality.
Here to debate the matter are Christopher Tookey, film critic of the Daily Mail, who's calling for Crash to be banned, Sheila Whitaker, the director of the London Film Festival, where Crash had its only British screenings, Alexander Walker, the veteran film critic who writes for the Evening Standard, he's firmly anti-censorship, Christina Rees, a member of the General Synod of the Church of England, and Tom Dewe Mathews, a writer and expert on film censorship, whose views we've just heard. Christopher Tookey, it was your column in the Daily Mail Mail that not only called for the film to be banned by the censor, but also called for a boycott of the goods of Sony, who own the distributing company. You obviously feel very strongly about it. Why?
The reason I feel strongly about this is that I noticed that David Cronenberg didn't use one word in his speech, and that was responsibility. And I think that filmmakers do have some moral and social responsibility. And Crash is not an outrageously violent film. There are many more violent films, among them Braveheart. It's not an outrageously sexy film. There have been many more hardcore pornographic films than this. What is, in my view, unique about it is the fact that it's eroticizing mutilation. It's actually saying that mutilation is one of the great things you can do for somebody. It's taking a non-judgmental view of mutilation. And it seems to me that if you let this through, it would act not only as a way of exposing some darker sides of people's sexuality to themselves when they see this movie, which could be possibly harmful, I also think it would be an incredibly bad precedent.
Don't we want to see the darker side of ourselves in works of art?
I don't mind seeing the darker sides of ourselves. What I think is probably noxious is the fact that if you eroticize it, if you make it attractive to people without any moral context whatsoever, without any sign or indication of the harm that mutilation, car crashes, etc., can cause to other people, then I think you're actually acting as a distorting influence on society.
Alex Walker, you consider the film, in your column, you said you felt it was immoral, this film. You do not feel that it has a morality, that the morality of the filmmaker is separate from the behaviour, the depraved behaviour of the people he's showing in the film.
No, I don't separate craftsmanship from content. I mean, Mein Kampf was quite a well-written book too. But Cronenberg gives a very smooth defense of his film. Actually, he doesn't refer to the film that he's made, he refers to the film that he thinks he's made. My view was that Crash is a deeply immoral and a pornographic film.
Why?
All the characters in it, for example, are defined only through their sexuality, through their perverted sexuality.
It's a film about sexuality.
That's right, but there are other aspects of the characters, their social connections with the community around them, that are not treated in the film at all. It happens in a moral vacuum. There's no human shading to those characters at all. They are simply embodiments of sexual perversions. Moreover, you didn't show any clips that would in fact have aroused the public to the actual nature of the argument that J.G. Ballard and David Cronenberg proselytized this film with.
They say that it is a warning about the possibilities of the future, the engagement of humanity
yes.
with technology.
Well, I say it's an exploitation about some of the darker forces in society, which have no moral context at all. As Christopher has said, they're presented in an entirely non-judgmental, cool way, which in fact is an extremely decadent way to approach them.
Is there a moral viewpoint? Is there a moral point?
I'm just a bit gobsmacked. I just think, first of all, we're talking about responsibility of the filmmaker. I do think there is a point about the responsibility of a journalist. You are one man in 60 million who has access to a national newspaper, and you're able to write things which I think, frankly, are misleading and misrepresent the film. I accept Alex's point that in a sense, what Cronenberg has done is set he doesn't like the word moral fable, but I think it is a moral fable. What he is talking about, and I think your point about it's about sex and violence leading to eroticism, I think the film is the most unerotic film one can imagine. Now, it's totally unerotic, and if you look at the interpretation of pornography is supposedly explicit, leading to eroticism. And this is not that explicit, and it certainly doesn't lead to eroticism.
This is very explicit, if you'll forgive me. For instance, the orthopedic fetishism of the Rosanna Arquette character, who goes around in all kinds of splints, is not put in to show any sympathy with the sexual dilemma of people who are handicapped, but to exploit the fetishism of those people who adopt the prosthetics of the handicapped for sexual pleasure.
Wait a minute. We've got a lot of people who know a lot about movies here. We've got film critics and people who are expert on film. Christina is a cinema goer with a strong interest in film, and you saw the film. What did you make of it?
I did indeed. Well, I think I would have to agree with Alex that it was probably amoral. And if you, Sheila...
Alex said immoral.
I said
immoral. Well, I think it's amoral because the characters were not allowed to have any or show us any emotions except sexual arousal. And this was all done connected to the violence and the mutilations that have been discussed. Now, if this is indeed, as you say, Sheila, a moral fable, what I understand about fables from reading them all my life is that usually by the end you get the author's point of view on what has gone on. And yes, you are shown the dark side and there is a wicked witch or whatever, but at the end of it you come around saying, ah, but this is a guide on how we're to think about this. I think the disturbing thing for me was leaving it open-ended about whether or not we should think now about whether destruction on the motorways can release sexual energy. To me, that is an obscene thought.
Okay, so you want it banned. You don't want it banned because of the sex, because as you say, there's plenty of more sex in other movies, or the violence.
I'll just come in this point of Tom. That they're picking up on. It isn't necessarily the role of the filmmaker to provide moral closure, that it's in fact probably truer to say that the film director, a serious film director, should be asking questions, and he's not necessarily going to provide answers to those questions. And this is particularly true to Cronenberg, that he says that he's trying to explore a form of sexuality. Now, Christopher says he's trying to promote it. I personally don't think so, but that's not the point. The point is that he doesn't have to say this is a bad route to follow.
I think he does.
He doesn't have to be a judge.
He's dealing with extremely inflammatory material. The material being bringing sadomasochism.
And so he should be as a serious director.
Bringing,
that's exactly the sort of material.
Bringing
he should
sadomasochism
be doing.
Onto the public highway.
Well, I just love
Sheila. But I do think that maybe the big problem here is that we shouldn't allow filmmakers to talk about their films, because as Cronenberg himself says, the film that I've made is not necessarily the man that is sitting here talking to you now. And I think there is always a big problem in trying to put one with the other. Let's just look at the film. And I think the problem, if I may say, for a lot of people about the film is simply that it doesn't give you any moral judgments. You, the viewer, have to make your moral judgment. What it's saying is, this is the way technology, we are internalizing technology to such a point, this is maybe one route that some people might follow. And it's not saying, isn't this bad or isn't this good? It's saying, look, folks, shouldn't we be thinking about this?
Do you think it seems to me?
But also,
can I just say one more thing? It seems to me that you've got as many films as there are people who watch them. This is the big problem, because we all around this here have slightly different views of this film. And it seems to me that you have to, in a democracy, which is a good point that he made, we have to rely on the fact that the majority of the population are good, normal living people who will either reject the film because they don't understand it or don't want to understand it or think it's boring, which some people do, or they're going to go away and think, my God, yes, this is, you know, whatever. But we have to give them the opportunity of doing so, or not even seeing the film at all, if they don't want to.
A film for adults, Christopher?
Well, I mean, I just love this description of David Cronenberg as a serious filmmaker. I mean, come on, this is the man who started off doing films about exploding heads. Then he went on to do things
like...
Well,
what does it matter how he started off? We're talking about Crash.
His entire career has been based on a wish to shock. He's recently had two flop art house movies, M. Butterfly and The Naked Lunch, which both failed critically and failed commercially.
Because of your view of his career, nobody else should see the film.
No, I'm just saying that I don't find it. You suspect his motive. I very much suspect.
And what do you think his motives are?
I think his motives are to find material that is sufficiently shocking to be able to get the film enough publicity to be released rather than
Do you think the public can judge that for themselves?
Well, I think there's a great tendency on programmes like this and in the pages of the Daily Telegraph or the Guardian to say, we're all reasonable, nice, humane people. Well, no doubt we are. The fact remains, as we constantly read in the papers, there are lots of people, a minority certainly, who are not like that.
Now there is an interesting issue, a point that he's made, a factual point, which is that the film has been widely seen in other countries and hasn't felt this kind of breath of disapproval ahead of the censor making any judgment.
We only have David Cronenberg's voice for that. I can assure you that the clippings I have received from other countries, of other critics, are making exactly the same points as I'm making. But Mr. Cronenberg very cannily keeps that voice of opposition out of his arguments.
You disapprove of the film. Do you want it banned?
No, I don't want it banned, because why should I deprive you of the opportunity of agreeing with me? Of course not.
Christopher, what about that point? Why can't we all judge it? It hasn't corrupted you or led you to be a dangerous driver, I assume?
No, I don't consider myself particularly at risk from a sadomasochistic, eroticising film. I've no doubt that others would be more at risk.
It depends. The point is this, you can't restrain people's artistic imagination.
Well, indeed you can. We have censors.
Yes, we can. But I think the more serious point that Christopher's taking here is that this promotes a form of sexuality, and that this is an insidious lie that has been perpetuated mostly by censors, where you say that somehow that sexuality isn't an orientation, it's a choice. That as every student, a GSE student in biology, would be able to tell you, sex is an orientation, not an act, and therefore you can't sort of say, well, actually, well, it's Monday, I feel like a sadomasochist. Hang on, I feel like a sadomasochist today. Oh, it's Tuesday, I feel homosexual today. Maybe I'll become a ballerina on Wednesday. I mean, this is madness, that think people somehow, and he uses the word that it contaminates, that somehow sex is a disease that you catch.
We're not talking of sex, we're talking of a particular...
I don't think we're actually as fixed sexually as you would have us do. I think people do change and react.
Yes.
I think we are also, I disagree with David Cronenberg, we actually are a product of our society. We would be very different people if we'd been brought up somewhere else in another time. I'm not sure that this film should be censored because I've seen worse and I didn't think it was that. I think what worried me about this film is even leaving a thought in people's mind that, well, shall we put on the table and now think about combining sexuality, which to me is something to do with love, with this thought of destruction and violence with machines in a completely impersonal way.
One of the hardest areas of censorship law to apply is blasphemy. Britain's blasphemy laws are based upon medieval edicts, which in turn sprang from biblical texts, the same texts as those under which Jesus was reportedly tried and sentenced to death. Application of these laws has always been problematic because it requires evidence that a piece of work is scurrilous, abusive, or offensive about the Christian religion. In Britain, there have only been two successful prosecutions under the blasphemy laws this century. The last in 1977, when Mary Whitehouse brought a private prosecution against Gay News for printing a poem in which a gay centurion fantasizes about sex with Jesus on the cross. Since then, there have been regular attempts by private individuals to apply the blasphemy laws, most notably in high-profile cases such as Martin Scorsese's film The Last Temptation of Christ and the Monty Python comedy The Life of Brian. None of them was successful. In 1989, there were also attempts by the Muslim community to prosecute Salman Rushdie over his novel The Satanic Verses. These failed on the grounds that British blasphemy law applies solely to Christianity. While the government has made it clear that it won't itself prosecute anyone under the blasphemy laws, it has resisted attempts to abolish them. More significantly, the government has, for the last 7 years, supported the efforts of the British Board of Film Classification to ban Visions of Ecstasy, a video by the writer and director Nigel Wingrove about St. Teresa of Avila. In a recent ruling, the European Court of Human Rights upheld the British government's right to curtail Wingrove's freedom of speech under Britain's blasphemy law.
Joining this part of the debate is Nigel Wingrove, the director of Visions of Ecstasy. Now let's turn the subject round and look at it as the issue of the encroachment on the freedom of people to say what they want and express themselves as they choose. Now, Alex, are we in danger of encroaching too far?
Yes, I think we are. But then you must remember that censorship through the British Board of Film Classification is not the way to do it.
You're against the censor.
I'm against the censor because I think that private confabs between the censors appointed by the film trade and the makers of the movies is not the way to inform the public about what their freedoms should be.
What should we have?
Well, we already have quite an arsenal of legislation that's been passed, from the Obscene Publications Act, the Indecency Act, the Protection of Children Act, directly applicable to a film like Kids, right up to the Video Recordings Act, that
Isn't
determines.
That enough?
I think that that's more than enough, because I think that although you've got to say that all freedoms are conditional and all liberties are contingent, depending on where society thinks it is at the moment, when you have a combination of heavy-powered legislative artillery like that, freedoms can get shot down.
Well, one person who's had his freedom shot down, or believes he has, is Nigel Wingrove. Nigel, your film was accused under a law you didn't mention, the blasphemy law, and it was found to be blasphemous in this country, and it went to Europe, and it was found to be blasphemous there.
Well, it was never actually found to be blasphemous. The BBFC thought it was potentially blasphemous. It was never been tried in a court of law.
Given that a lot of religious people have said that this offends their feelings, you must accept that.
Well, I haven't actually, as of now, I mean, over the last 7 years, not one religious person who's seen the film has said it was blasphemous. The worst that was said of it was a Catholic man said he found it offensive, but he said it fell short of a blasphemy because I hadn't made the film about Christ. I made the film about St. Teresa, not in my own way, and I wasn't attributing anything to Christ.
Now, Christina, you haven't seen the film, but you're a devout Christian, and so your concept of blasphemy is associated with your Christian belief. How would you define it?
I think blasphemy for me would be mocking the goodness of God as I see it. From what I understand about this particular film, I don't have a problem with a filmmaker putting the figure of Jesus Christ in an erotic clinch with someone or fantasizing about what his earthly life might have been like. But I think I would have a problem if at the point of his death, where he was in absolute physical agony, if we understand what crucifixion would have been like, and if at that moment one of his followers or someone who supposedly loved him were to find his hanging there and bleeding an erotic moment. That would upset me. Whether it's blasphemous or not, I don't know.
The difficulty with blasphemy, most particularly, is it's about people's feelings. How can we legislate so that nobody's feelings are offended? What happens, Tom?
Well, I think in this particular case, it's interesting because with Visions of Ecstasy, it's a film about the eroticization of religious feeling. And as the writer Marina Warner has said, Catholics have a language of voluptuousness. It is St. Catherine, St. Teresa, had these visions of religious sexual revelation of entering the wound of Christ, being lost in their wounds. So for some of us, I mean, as a lapsed Catholic, say, it wasn't quite sexy enough. It didn't push its argument quite far enough. But for others, as the censor said when he was processing the film, that he banned it because Christ moved. He, in effect, I think, told you that he wanted Christ to be a block of wood.
There was basically, if I had a wooden image of Christ, I mean, anything apparently could have been done to vomited on it or anything offensive. But it's only because I used a living Christ and there was a tear and his hands moved. It was those two bits that showed a response to the caresses of the woman that I was representing, Teresa, and that was the blasphemy. If he hadn't moved, it wouldn't be blasphemous. At least, but I'd say it wasn't a court of law. You're talking about civil servant or censors trying to define a law that's incredibly difficult to define anyway, and they shouldn't have been involved in it. I think they should have kept out of it.
It raises the point that Cronenberg makes, which is that you end up arguing about tiny details which are hard to define. Chris, what would you like to see happen?
Well, I've seen Nigel's film, and I feel that he is, in a way, a butterfly broken on a wheel, to paraphrase William Rees-Mogg long ago. I mean, I think some people would undoubtedly find it offensive. Many more Christians who I know would actually laugh at it. I mean, it's a fairly anodyne piece of soft porn in many ways.
You wouldn't ban it?
Well, I don't think one should ban films purely on grounds of offence. I think a film has to do more. Offence is not enough. And I think also with the Blasphemy Act, we're getting into very dangerous areas if we just say that only Christians have the right to have their feelings respected.
What about Jews? What about Jews? Exactly. What about Muslims?
And where does that all end, Alex?
And the blasphemy law only applies to the Anglican faith.
It doesn't end. It goes on cyclically. Yeah. Sometimes the tolerance of society is extended to movies, like happened to us during the 60s when we had the Permissive Society. We're now, I think, in a period where people are becoming more and more intolerant because they are afflicted. They are afflicted, puritanically so, by imagery that seems to them savage, threatening, and here and now, a clear and present danger to themselves. I think when you're in that particular situation, then the society vents its spleen upon the thing that is most prominent in its vicinity, which in many cases happens to be a blockbuster movie.
Christina, as someone concerned with the community, family and so on, do you feel you recognise the point at which people, the vulnerable, need to be protected? The phrase copycat has been used about events in films. Now, do you think we need to be on guard against that, or do you think it's a scare word?
I think, well, first of all, it is now a scare word for us, and I think we're heightened consciousness about the potentiality of a copycat, and I don't think it's ever been completely proven, but I think a lot of hundreds of advertisers can't be misguided when they spend thousands and thousands of pounds for 30 seconds and 60 seconds to make us get up and go copy someone who's just used their product. Yes. So I actually think that the moving image is extremely powerful, and I have to say that we do need responsibility. I would prefer it to reside in the artist, the filmmaker, the novelist,
the
him
critic.
Or herself.
Tom.
The censor doesn't ban films. Newspapers ban films in this country.
Christopher.
Yes, and journalists like Christopher. Through their use of emotive language, depraved, paedophiliac, the sort of film of sadists, etc., they build this up, and then they use cases, they link them to murders, which there isn't any linkage, but it's all flagged up, and so the hysteria is built up. So the censor is in an impossible position.
Christopher, you're the censor in this country.
I don't think I am at all, no. I'm paid to express my opinion, and I think I would be irresponsible as a critic if I left moral and social considerations out of my view.
Your opinion is part of a campaign. It's within a campaign saying, ban this film. And this, it's supported by other articles, lead headlines. You are part of, of an
Christina,
industry.
Christina, do you think Christopher represents public opinion?
I think he represents a wide band of public opinion, but not all of public opinion. And I think you can actually affect public opinion. I would have to agree with that, that a lot of people will read what you say and make
obviously.
Up their minds.
Yes.
But that's a position of great power.
Now, everybody has called for responsibility. Nigel, you too. You're here perhaps as a maker of a more of extreme film. Would you call for responsibility?
I'm not glib enough to think the films don't have an influence. I think films do. Where I get fed up is that by the press calling for films to be banned because they might have an adverse influence on a particular individual, then they're absolving individuals of their own responsibility. I mean, if I was to go and get drunk and hurt somebody, then I can't blame the alcohol. I mean, it's my choice to drink the alcohol. If I see a film, I can't say, oh, this film exalts you of all responsibility. Now I can go out and commit those things. So I think it's wrong to say that it doesn't have an influence. I think the film does have an influence, but I think you can't allow individuals to absolve themselves of all responsibility because they can blame everything on the film. And I think that's the trouble.
I totally agree with that. Yes. Of course, it doesn't absolve anybody of moral responsibility.
Well, the question that follows is that if we're saying everybody should be free to make what they want with a sense of responsibility and right through the film industry that should operate to, how are we to arrive at a situation in which we credit everybody with the maturity to make responsible judgments?
Well, we don't.
That's the whole problem.
We employ critics to make responsible judgments.
We look to you for leadership.
Yes, I don't try and second-guess the public. Because if you do that, you're through as a critic.
But that opinion
is based upon a great body of knowledge and the ability to compare.
If you ask everybody, including around this table or went anywhere, and you said, do you believe in censorship for yourself? They would say, no, I don't. But if you ask them, what about the person next to you? A lot of people would say yes. So it's always the assumption that somebody's out there, which is Cronenberg's point, that they'll do it. But once you start to sort of bite in with these little bites, Northern Ireland, sexual violence, these sort of encroachments, sort of biting off bits that you can't talk about, then you're not leaving this area free where adults can talk to each other, which is vital.
Do you think you might have spearheaded, willingly or unwillingly, Christopher, a swathe of puritanical feeling that is going to encroach even further?
No, I don't think so. I think there is a wave of concern in the wake of things like Dunblane, the troubles in the schools and so on. And I think that is not moral panic, I think that's genuine social concern. There's a feeling that we've gone wrong somewhere. And I think there's a great tendency to use films as a scapegoat, I must say. And films, of course, are only one of numerous influences, among which are the breakdown of the family, or, you know, all sorts of different characteristics. And films are, I think, relatively trivial.
what we need is, if we're going to have censorship at all, and most of it is not necessary, then it should be transparent censorship, that we know when it's been censored and why.